Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our morning online service from the Westside Church of Christ here on our YouTube live channel. The Westside Church of Christ that normally meets at 2255 Totten Road, and earlier this morning we had our live service at 10:15. And you, as a viewer, if you're ever in Windsor or if you are in Windsor, you are more than welcome to join us. We would prefer you to register, and we have a link to do that, and I can send it to you, or you can email me at westsidewindsorcoc@gmail.com, and you will be more than welcome to join with other worshipers of God and followers of Jesus. We're glad that you have chosen, however, to spend some moments of your week or at the beginning of your week with us as we think about Jesus and all the great things that God has done for us through Jesus and all the great things God continues to do for us through Jesus and will do for us through Jesus. Our hope in this world and the next, of course, is Jesus himself. And so what better way to begin each week than to have a reminder of who we are, that we are deeply loved by Jesus, he whose own essence is love. And so we're going to give people a few moments to join us. Please, if you know these songs, please sing along with them at home. And if you don't feel comfortable doing that, please let these songs guide the meditation and worship of your heart this morning.
You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel, Lord, to give up I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Taking my sin, my cross, my shame, rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all. Jesus,
you are my strength when I am
Lamb.
You are the treasure that I seek.
Worthy
you are my
is your name. Jesus,
seeking you as a precious
Lamb. My sin, my cross, my shame, rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of
servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice.
It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest. The fields are wide in the world, and we are the laborers in your vineyard declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet calls, so lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet calls, so lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. You are beautiful beyond description, too marvelous for words, too wonderful for comprehension, like nothing ever seen or heard. Who can grasp your infinite wisdom? Who can fathom the depth of your love? You are beautiful beyond description, majesty enthroned above. And I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you. Holy God, to whom all praise is due, I stand in awe of you. You are beautiful beyond description, too marvelous for words, too wonderful for comprehension, like nothing ever seen or heard. Who can grasp your infinite wisdom? Who can fathom the depth of your love? You are beautiful beyond description, majesty enthroned above. And I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you. Holy God, to whom all praise is due, I stand in awe of you. And I stand I stand in awe of you. Holy God, to whom all praise is due, I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you. I stand in
morning, everyone. Again, nice to think of those songs and hear them sung and to sing them, and maybe one day we'll all be able to sing again together. We're going to notice in our daily readings of the Bible that we're going through as a church in this year, in 2021, we're going to notice that we're going to be going through quickly now through the remainder, but we're in the book of Daniel this morning, and we're going to get there in just a few moments. But I want to welcome you once again. I want to begin, though, by reading from the New Testament book, the last book, Revelation chapter 1, beginning at verse 12 to verse 18. It's a really fascinating reading that the Apostle John gives us about a vision that he has in Revelation chapter 1, beginning at verse 12. He says, "Then I turned to see the voice that was speaking to me, and on turning I saw seven golden lampstands. And in the midst of the lampstands, one like a son of man. So please remember that for our lesson today. I saw one like a son of man, clothed with a long robe and with a golden sash around his chest. The hairs of his head were white like wool, as white as snow. His eyes were like a flame of fire. His feet were like burnished bronze refined in a furnace, and his voice was like the roar of many waters. In his right hand he held 7 stars. From his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword, and his face was like the sun shining in full length. And when I saw him, John says, I fell at his feet as though dead, but he laid his right hand on me, saying, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last, and the living one. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and of Hades. And you've got John's vision of the vindicated and glorified Son of Man. He informs John that, yes, he was dead. He had suffered and died. He was killed, but he is alive forevermore, never to die again. And who alone controls the realm of the dead? He has the keys of death and of Hades, or the grave. He alone controls the realm of death. And what is his message to John, his faithful servant? His message is, don't be afraid. I have complete control. I want to ask you a question this morning before we begin. Just a simple question, actually, and one I think that we all can relate well with, is how often do we as humans fill in the blanks when something is apparently missing? And the answer is, we probably do it a lot more often than we realize. And why we don't realize it is because, as we usually fill in the blanks, everything that we're doing seems to make complete sense, and so there is no reason to notice we are filling in the blanks. Our human brains, we're told, do this in order that we can make sense of the world around us. I mean, who among us has not enjoyed having a spouse or sibling or child or friend help us finish our sentences, right? You're trying to say something and someone decides they're going to finish the sentence for you. If you were in church this morning, I had an exercise on the board, but I'll share it with you. I just want to go through a list of numbers and see if you can help me fill in the blank. The list of numbers was something like this: 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, blank, 14, 16, 18, 20. Now fill in the blank for me. And when you think about this, your answer is probably 12. You filled in the blank. Now, when you think about it, you had no absolute knowledge that the missing number was 12 in the list, but you were pretty sure that it had to be 12 in order for things to make sense. Filling in the blanks is something we all do if you're hard of hearing, for instance, and closed captioning isn't on. It's probably something you do a lot when you're watching television. We humans fill in blanks. We do this, and it's a positive trait, we do this as a means of protecting ourselves against chaos. But the challenge for us is being able to accept at times that the blank we filled might have been filled in wrong. That list might have been 11 instead of 12. Who knows? And when we talk about filling in the blanks, sometimes we can do it even with the Bible. I want us to spend a couple of minutes this morning just looking at 2 sets of passages from the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And we're only going to focus on Matthew's uses of them, but Luke and Mark both have similar passages that correspond to each of these in Matthew. So they're in Matthew, Mark, or Luke. But it's just 2 sets of passages that Jesus spoke about coming on the clouds of heaven. And even as I say that, coming on the clouds of heaven, you, if you're familiar with Scripture at all, might be filling in the scene already. You might be filling in the blanks. But the first passage is, the first set of passages from predictions concerning the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple that Jesus spoke. And in Matthew chapter 24 and verse 30, Jesus says, then will appear in heaven the sign of the Son of Man, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. So that's the first one. That in heaven will appear the sign of the Son of Man, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven. The second set is from the trial of Jesus just a few days later when he was before the high priest. And it's found in Matthew chapter 26 and verse 64. The parallel passages are Mark 14, 62 and Luke 22 and verse 69. But Matthew's passage, Jesus says to the high priest, "You have said so, but I tell you, from now on," remember that line, "from now on, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven." So as we hear or read and think about those passages, are there any blanks we're filling in? And surprisingly, there's quite a few. Because when we notice those passages alone, Jesus does not provide much when it comes to the geography that he's talking about. He doesn't say where he is coming from or where he is coming to. That's not what Jesus includes, but we probably have filled in some of the blanks in our mind. To make sense of this, we begin to fill in the blanks. The second thing is you'll notice is that Jesus does not say much specifically about the time, except to the chief priest when he says, "from now on." From now on, you'll see this. Not someday in the future, not at the end, but from now on. So it's important to remember that. I want us to keep that in the back of our mind because we want to look, as I said this morning, at a great book and character named Daniel, who would have been really well known in the days of Jesus. In fact, Jesus quotes from Daniel quite a few times in the Gospels. Now, just kind of setting ourselves up with our reading, we read the book of Jeremiah, then we read his little book of Lamentations, then we read the book of Ezekiel, and this week we've read the book of Daniel. And what we know about these three prophets is that Daniel, Ezekiel, and Jeremiah were all kind of compatriots. Jeremiah, of course, was older. Daniel was taken to Babylon about 8 years before Ezekiel was, but those two are roughly the same age. And by the time we're reading the books of Daniel and Ezekiel, Jeremiah would have been in Egypt by that time, ministering to the Jews who had fled to Egypt. Ezekiel was by the rivers of Babylon. And Daniel, as we read, ends up in the court of the king. He's in the palace court. If you're familiar at all with the book of Daniel, you know that Daniel seems to be a tale of two kinds of books. Number one, the first six chapters, it's full of great stories of how the faithful Jew and his friends resist the pagan king and are rescued by God. And they're great stories. They're great stories for Sunday school. They're great stories for adults trying to live by faith. That these four faithful Jews, they hold on to God. They hold on to their ancient faith. They hold on to the hope that they have in the God of heaven and earth. And they resist all the pressures and temptations and trials. And they get rescued over and over again. And then the second half, a lot of times people want to skip the second half. It's full of these deep prophecies that are admittedly difficult to piece together. And you kind of need a knowledgeable hand to guide you through world history to kind of put it all together. And so there's some truth to these divisions in the book. But the thing we just want to caution about is making too much of there being a division, because what we notice in the book of Daniel is there is a connected overall theme, both with the stories and the prophecies. You have these pagan rulers who are attacking God's people, and they boast arrogantly against God. And on the other side, you have faithful Israelites, faithful servants of God, who are holding on to their God, who are holding on to their faith in their God, And in the end, God vindicates them. And this plays a part in all of the book of Daniel. In chapter 1, you have the king's rich food, and Daniel and his friends won't defile themselves with it, and they are vindicated in the end. In chapter 2, you have the king's dream, and Daniel and his friends are at risk of losing their life, but it's God's faithful servant who reveals the king's dream and reveals the victorious kingdom of God. In chapter 3, you have the fiery furnace, and Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego refuse to bow down to anyone other than their God. And they say, our God is able to deliver us, but even if he doesn't, we're not going to bow down. They get thrown into the fiery furnace, and God rescues them. In chapter 4, you've got again the king's dream, and he's boasting. He's boasting about how great he is. He's boasting against the God of heaven. And Daniel interprets it again, and the king descends into madness. You have chapter 5, and the king throws a banquet, and again, this boasting, but there's the writing on the wall, and the God of heaven is going to be victorious. In chapter 6, you have Daniel and the lion's den. We're going to talk a little bit more about that later, but Daniel holds on to his God, and he's vindicated in the end by his God. Chapter 7, you have the beasts of the earth and the vindication and glorification of the Son of Man. We'll talk about that in a few moments. Chapter 8, you've got the ram, the goat, and the horns, and the victory of God's faithful servants. In chapter 9, you have Daniel's prayer and the abomination of desolation, but Daniel's vision, God's faithful people win in the end. And then there's going to lead to one great vindication, but we're going to talk about that in a little bit. I want us to spend time this morning in chapter 6 and then mainly in chapter 7. In Luke chapter 24, the last verses of Luke's gospel, you have Jesus rising from the dead and speaking to his disciples. And Jesus has gone through the horrible suffering at the hands of sinful humanity. He has suffered tragically on the cross. But as he has risen from the dead, he proceeds to explain to his followers that the sufferings of the Christ were necessary. And the Christ would rise from the dead. This was necessary. This is what the law of Moses taught. And then Jesus says, and now repentance and forgiveness of sins could be announced in his name to all nations. We know from all four Gospels that Jesus was rescued from death and vindicated by God. And then in the last few verses of Luke, you notice the scene that Jesus ascends from earth to heaven. Luke says he's carried up into heaven. And we know that the new age is firmly in place. Jesus is Lord of heaven and earth. Jesus is now glorified. So Daniel 6 tells the story that many Bible readers are familiar with, tells the story of jealous fellow servants who are looking to, quote, nail Daniel. They want to nail Daniel with something. That's their whole purpose. They search for something to nail him with. And they come to the realization that in order to do so, they must make something connected to the law of Daniel's God illegal. That's what they've got to do. That's what they got to do. They got to somehow make something that Daniel must do for God to be illegal. And so what they end up doing is pretty smart. They make praying illegal. There can be no petition to God. And what we know when we read Daniel chapter 6 is that this law reaches even into the homes of people. So it's not public prayer. It's private prayer. And so they reach even into the homes of people. All right. And so what happens if you break this? Well, you and I know the story well. What happens if you break this is you get thrown into a den of lions. You get thrown into a pit with ferocious beasts. That's what happens. Daniel knows this is signed, and he opens his window, basically. And he prays to God three times a day. And here's the question. Daniel gets thrown in the lion's den, and in chapter 7 and verse 20, Here is the question the king asks. He says in verse 20, O Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to deliver you from the lions? And that's the question. And I want to put forth to you, that's one of the themes of the entire book. I want to put forth to you, that's one of the themes of the entire Bible. Has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to deliver you from the lions? That's the question. I want to just encourage you for a moment to think, how have you been able to answer that question? Can you answer that question? This is the question. I remember a preacher long ago when Sarah and I was at a lectureship asking his son, and said, and his son's name was Daniel, in fact, he said, Daniel, what would you do if, like Daniel in the Bible, you were thrown into the den of lions? And of course, living in today's world, he said, I'd get my guns and I'd shoot those lions. And his father said, no, but Daniel, wouldn't you want to be like Daniel? Where you didn't use your guns and you just trusted in God and you didn't do anything wrong. Wouldn't you want to be like Daniel? Is your God, whom you serve continually, been able to deliver you from the lions? And Daniel says that God had sent his angel to protect me. Daniel is vindicated. It says in verse 23 that no harm was found on him because he trusted in his God. He's in the midst of the beasts and he's vindicated. He's raised up and no harm is found on him because he trusts in his God. And then the announcement comes from the king, and King Darius says that the God of Daniel, he is the living God, enduring forever. His kingdom shall never be destroyed. His dominion shall be to the end. He delivers and rescues. He works signs and wonders in heaven and on earth. He who has saved Daniel from the power of the lions. And this is the message, isn't it? That God delivers and rescues. He works signs and wonders in heaven and on earth. He who has saved Daniel from the power of the lions. And so now we make the turn into chapter 7. And we notice in chapter 7 that this is Daniel's dream. And in Daniel's dream, it's a terrifying dream. Beasts come up out of the sea, and each one different, but all of them vicious. And they're set on the earth. Later on in the interpretation in chapter 7 and verse 17, it says, these four beasts represent four kings of the earth, and they are vicious and they are terrifying. And the fourth being the worst of all. From history, we know there are four great kingdoms that began with Nebuchadnezzar. There's the Babylonian kingdom, the Medo-Persian kingdom, the Grecian kingdom, and then the Roman kingdom, who were in power when Jesus came and when Peter and Paul preached. And right in the midst of these terrifying beasts, and try to remember that just the previous chapter, Daniel was in the midst of those terrifying lions. It says at the end of verse 8 that the horn of the fourth beast is speaking great things. Remember the boasting of world powers. And right in the midst, it says in verse 9 and verse 10 that thrones were placed and the Ancient of Days took his seat. His clothing was white as snow, and the hair of his head like pure wool. His throne was fiery flames. Its wheels were burning fire. A stream of fire issued and came out from before him. 1,000,000 served him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court sat in judgment, and the books were opened. One of the first things of importance for people of faith: God's throne in heaven is always occupied. It's never vacant, and it's never thrown down. There is a throne in heaven, and it is occupied. And it is the God of Jesus, the God of Daniel, who sits in the throne. This God is above all and has judgment over all. No matter how fierce the beast might look, the Ancient of Days is more powerful and presides over all. The Ancient of Days has richer glory than anything else in the history of the world, even combined. And as Daniel sees, the beasts are done, the kingdoms are taken away, the last beast, the most terrifying, is destroyed. And in the midst of all this happening, Daniel's great vision, a vision that we don't need to fill in the blanks with as much. He says in verse 13, I saw in the night visions, behold, with the clouds of heaven. Remember hearing that in Matthew, right? With the clouds of heaven, there came one like a son of man, just like what Jesus said, and he came to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him, and to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom one that shall not be destroyed. That in the midst of the beasts, as terrifying as they are, a son of man is lifted up. And he comes with the clouds of heaven, but the direction is clear in the book of Daniel. He is coming not from the Ancient of Days, he is coming to the Ancient of Days. The son of man comes with the clouds of heaven to God. And when he comes to God with the clouds of heaven, he is given dominion, glory, and a kingdom. A dominion which is everlasting and a kingdom that will never be destroyed. Like Daniel in chapter 6, the Son of Man will be vindicated. God is able to deliver the Son of Man. Jesus is sent to the lion's den. He faces the powers of evil. He suffers. He struggles. But like Daniel, Jesus has been the faithful servant. He continually serves God. And we ask him the question, is your God, whom you serve continually, able to deliver you, Jesus, Son of Man? And the answer is what Jesus said it was going to be. From now on, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming with the clouds of heaven. There is no harm done to the Son of Man because he trusts in his God. Daniel's visions tell a story that doesn't even end there, though. In chapter 2, remember, Daniel sees the vision of the four kingdoms, but the victorious kingdom of God smashing into pieces all other kingdoms. Daniel 7, he sees the vision of the victorious Son of Man who is given the kingdom that is everlasting. But then in chapter 12, Daniel sees the vision of the victorious and delivered people of the one true God. And now I will show you the truth. Behold, three more kings shall arise in Persia, and a fourth shall be far richer than all of them. And when he... Chapter 12. At that time shall arise Michael, the great prince, who has charge of your people, and there shall be a time of trouble such as never has been since there was a nation till that time. But at that time, your people shall be delivered, everyone whose name shall be found written in the book, and many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the sky above, and those who turn many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. Daniel sees the vision of the victorious and delivered people of the one true God. At that time, your people will be delivered. This is the great message. Is your God, whom you serve continually, able to deliver you? In Romans chapter 8, the Apostle Paul connected the victory of Jesus with our victory. He said, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor any other thing in all of God's creation will be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Romans 8, 37 to 39. What do we need to do? When it gets difficult, when it gets hard, we need to hold on. We need to keep the faith. In the book of Acts, the first martyr story is told. And Stephen preaches about Jesus. His body is breaking under the force of those heavy stones. And what does Stephen see? He sees Jesus not sitting at God's right hand. He sees Jesus standing. Jesus standing at attention, ready to welcome his faithful servant home, telling his child, just hold on, just a little more, just a little longer. But the God that you serve continually, Stephen, he is able to deliver you. The Son of Man is in power, and our final victory is never in doubt. Just hold on. Just hold on.
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King.
Hallelujah,
no more crying there, we are going to see the King.
Hallelujah,
no more crying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King.
Hallelujah.
No more dying there, we are going to see the King.
Hallelujah.
No more dying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King.
Great thought to end our lesson with today, that we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we're going to see the King in a place where, like with Daniel, no harm can come to us. We'll be lifted up from the terrifying beasts around us, and no more dying, no more crying. We'll see the King. In Acts chapter 20, the Apostle Paul was talking to the Ephesian elders before leaving, and in verse 35, he brings up a fact about Jesus that we don't find anywhere else, but it's something that I think is appropriate as we meet around the Lord's table, remembering the death of Jesus and the voluntary aspect of his giving up his life on the cross for us. He said in verse 35, "In all these things I have shown you that by working hard we must help the weak, and remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. And no one was weaker than us, and Jesus helped us." And Jesus lived out his motto, "It's more blessed to give than to receive." And when we gather around the Lord's table, we're remembering that Jesus gave his own life, that God gave his Son, so we who were weak and helpless might find strength and life. Please bow with me for the bread. Father God, we are so thankful for you. We're thankful you watch over us. We're thankful you take care of us. Father, bless the bread. As we partake, help us to do so in a manner that's pleasing to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And let's remember the fruit of the vine. Father God, thank you once again for the fruit of the vine, which represents the blood of Christ, which you said for our forgiveness. Help us as we partake to do so that is worthy of honoring Jesus. It is through his name we pray. Amen. Thank you once again for joining us today. I want to encourage you that if you have any questions about being a Christian or how to become a Christian or salvation or baptism, to please consider emailing me, westsidewindsorcoc@gmail.com. It's not that I have all the answers, but I would like to discuss these questions with you. So that's westsidewindsorcoc@gmail.com. Also on our website, WindsorChurchOfChrist.Weebly.com, there are two sets of Bible lessons that might help you along this regard. There's Is Jesus for Real?, where we look at the truth of Jesus as presented in the Bible and whether or not it's truth that we can trust. And another series on baptism itself and the role that it always had in Scripture, but it specifically has in the New Testament church. So we'd encourage you to look that up as well. WindsorChurchOfChrist.weebly.com. Want to remember all those that we've been praying for. We want to remember our brother Victor Vasilevsky as he's recovering from his horrible accident at work. We want to remember Sharon Wessel, who is finally going to be able to go back to work after her horrible break in the fall, in the spring, sorry. She's going to start part-time in the first week of October. Want to remember Linda Dunn recovering from aneurysm surgery and so many others that we're thinking about. Please bow with me in a word of prayer. Father God, we are so thankful for you. We're thankful, Father, you continually watch over us. We're so thankful, Father, for the book of Daniel, the character of Daniel, but also the teachings of Daniel. Father, we're so grateful that you are the God who is able to deliver and that you vindicated Jesus. And Jesus now has won the victory for us so that we are always going to be assured of our victory, Father. Help us to hold on. Help us to hold on in faith. For it is through Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless everyone.